our brother Tom Richardson is going to be sharing God's Word. And so we welcome him to share God's Word this morning.
Thank you, Pastor. Morning. How is everybody? Give me a second to get mic'd up here. Time up, Manny. How's that? Can you hear me? Okay, cool. All right. I'm going to get right into it. We're running a little late, but I'll get through this as fast as I can. By a show of hands, how many of you guys were here the last time I spoke? Okay, about half of you. Okay. For those that were at the beach, okay, and weren't here, and to refresh everybody's memory, what I spoke about was renewing our minds. And I'm going to ask I'm going to ask the same questions today that I asked back in August. By a show of hands, does anyone here ever have negative thoughts? Almost everybody? Okay. How about doubts? Does anybody worry? Have fear? Okay. Meanwhile, struggle with stinking thinking. Today's message is titled Transformation, the Sequel. If you remember last time I spoke, it was on transformation. Today's a kind of a different transformation, as you'll learn as we go along. And I pray that in Jesus' name, that the Holy Spirit moves me to deliver the message the Lord has put on my heart in such a way that it will have a profound impact on everybody here, just like it's having on me. For those of you that have heard my testimony or heard the message God had me deliver back in August, it's obvious that I have a struggle with dark places and things. And I'm always on the search for peace. And isn't that what we're all looking for? Peace, right? Okay? And we're all in search of an eternal peace, not just when we leave this earth, but we want peace on earth as it is in heaven. Earlier as in the service, as we recited the Lord's Prayer, we recited, Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God's will on earth is the same as it is in heaven. I believe we can have peace on earth. Now, how many people are holding their breath? And this is rhetorical, you don't have to answer. How many people are holding their breath to find peace when they pass away or they're raptured up? Okay? I find myself in and out of peace all day long. I have been praying for peace for like 10 years. Recently, one afternoon, I was kind of bummed out, and I needed to be uplifted, so I turned on Praise the Lord, and there was a young fellow on there. His name is Johnny Moore, and he's a big shot at the Liberty College, the largest Christian college. And on the show, he was talking about a book he had written, How Do We Know If We're Doing God's Will? And the guy said, God isn't concerned with what you are doing. God is more concerned with what you are being. Bam, right there, I got a revelation. I had been asking God what he wants me to do in my business. I have been searching for the mechanics. God is more concerned with who we are. I watched this segment 3 times. And as a side note, if you're curious as to know if you're God's will, Johnny Moore says, pray, and if you have peace, you're on the right track. If along the way you lose your peace, you might be getting off track, and it's time to pray and correct your path. The Lord will let you know if you're in his will or not. So anyway, the revelation I received was to focus on who I'm becoming and not on what I'm doing. I tend to be somewhat religious and make lists of things I need to do. And that's not what it's about. It's about who are we being. So what or who are we supposed to be? I prayed, Lord, how do you want me to be in my business? And the Holy Spirit prompted me with one word, love. So today we're going to discuss love. Don't worry, we're not going to get all mushy and hold hands or anything. Because that's not what God's kind of love is. So first of all, we're going to define what love is. The Merriam-Webster Dictionary defines love this way. A feeling of strong or constant affection for a person. Attraction that includes sexual desire. The strong affection felt by people who have a romantic relationship. a person you love in a romantic way. Now, that definition pretty much defines a romantic kind of love, yet we use the word love in so many different contexts. We use it when we say, I love my spouse, I love my children, I love my brothers and sisters at church, I love God, I love Chinese food. We describe all these different statements with one word, when all these statements really have different meanings. I mean, really, is our love of God and people really the same as our love for our favorite food? I think not. I believe that the ancient Greeks were more accurate. They had four terms for love. Let's examine those. The first kind they have is called phileo. Phileo love refers to an affectionate, warm, and tender platonic love. It makes you desire friendship with someone. It is committed and chosen love. This is where the name Philadelphia is derived from. It means the city of brotherly love. Then there's storge love. It's actually looks like it's spelled storge, but I looked up the pronunciation. It says storge is a kind of family and friendship love. This is the love that parents naturally feel for their children, the love that members of the family have for each other, or the love that friends feel for each other. Storge love is unconditional, accepts flaws or faults, and ultimately drives you to forgive. It's committed, sacrificial, and makes you feel secure, comfortable, and safe. The third kind of love the Greeks had is eros, where the word erotic comes from. Eros is a passionate and intense love that arouses romantic feelings. It is the kind that often triggers high feelings in a new relationship and makes you feel all twitterpated. It is an emotional and sexual love. This romantic love is what we feel in the beginning of a new relationship. It usually does not last unless it moves to a higher level because it focuses more on self instead of on the other person. If the person in love does not feel good about their relationship anymore, they will stop loving their partner. And the fourth kind of love that the Greeks have a word for is agape love. This is God's kind of love. This is an unconditional love that sees beyond the outer surface and accepts the recipient for who he or she is, regardless of their flaws, shortcomings, or faults. It's the type of love that we should strive to have for our fellow human beings. Although we may not like someone, we decide to love them just as a human being. This kind of love is all about sacrifice, as well as giving and expecting nothing in return. Agape is the love demonstrated by our behavior towards other people, regardless of how we feel about them. It is a committed and chosen love. This is the way Jesus loves us. This is the way we are commanded to love one another. Notice, this is the only one of the four Greek terms for love that is not based on feelings. It's based on a decision to behave in a certain way. Obviously, these four definitions of love are better representation of the characteristics of love. The agape love we just defined is found in 1 Corinthians 13, verses 4 through 8. Love is patient. Love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. We may not always feel like doing these things, but in verse 8 we find out, love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. Now that we have defined love, what love is, let's move on to why we should love the agape way. The number one reason is that God commands it throughout the Bible. One day the Pharisees were testing Jesus, and in the book of Matthew, chapter 22, one of the Pharisees asked Jesus in verse 36, Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus said to him, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and all the prophets. What does that mean in verse 40? On these two commandments hang all the law and all the prophets. I believe that it's saying that all the other laws are based around love. So then wouldn't it make sense that if we focus on becoming love, that we would come into alignment with the other 613 laws of the Bible? If we focus on love, we will begin behaving better in every area of our life. Notice, I said behaving better, not feeling better necessarily. Remember, agape love is a decision of behavior and not about feelings. Okay, the greatest commandment. I don't know about you, but due to 50-plus years of living in this world, I have developed some bad programming. I have a mind and a heart virus that doesn't immediately allow this stuff to compute. I typically don't do things just because I'm commanded to. I want to know why. So let's talk about just five of the hundreds of reasons why we should love God. One of the first reasons to love God is because He created everything, and if He hadn't, we wouldn't even be here. Our love for God should start with the first 10 words written in the Bible. Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In Hebrews 3:4, it says, for every house is built by someone, but He who built all things is God. God created everything, including all of us. Wouldn't you agree that's a pretty good reason to love Him? Okay. The second reason for loving God is because He gives us free gifts. In James 1:17, it says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. Psalm 68:19, blessed be the Lord who daily loads us with benefits, the God of our salvation, Selah. As a side note, Selah is used a lot in the Psalms. What does Selah mean? The Amplified Bible interprets Selah to mean calmly pause and think about that. We should do that a lot when we study the Bible. Don't just read a passage in the Bible and move on, but calmly pause and think about what you're reading. This is where you will receive revelation, and revelation will change your life. Okay, the third reason we should love God is because He gave us the greatest gift of all. He sent His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to redeem us from our sins. We all know the verse, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Romans 5:8, but God demonstrates His own love towards us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God has given us everlasting life even though we don't deserve it. If that's not a good reason to choose to love God, then I don't know what is. The fourth reason to love God is because He answers our prayers. In Philippians 4:6, it says, be anxious for nothing but in everything by prayer and supplication. With thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Earlier, we agreed that we all want peace. There's the promise right there in verse 7. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Jesus Christ. Bam! I mean, there's what I've been looking for 10 years. In Hebrews 4:15 and 16, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Could you imagine being without sin? I mean, can't even fathom that for a minute, even though sometimes we think we're self-righteous. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. He sympathizes with our humanness and gives us grace and mercy even when we mess up. The fifth reason we should choose to love God is because He wants us to live with Him forever. John 14:1-3, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. How awesome is that? Okay, in 1 Corinthians 2:9, we read, but as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love Him. And I believe that's here on earth, and I believe that's in heaven. Okay, think about this verse for a minute. Imagine the most beautiful place you have ever seen on earth. Maybe somewhere you've visited. Maybe someplace you've seen on a postcard or in a magazine. Jesus said none of that compares to what he is preparing for all of us who love him. Let me ask you, in light of all these promises, who wouldn't choose to love God? Now let's turn this around. How do we show God that we love him? There are lots of ways. Praise and worship, prayer. I'm going to focus on just one thing. We show God we love him through our obedience. In 1 John chapter 5, verses 3 through 5, for the true love of God is this, that we do his commands, keep his ordinances, and are mindful of his precepts and teaching. And these orders of his are not irksome, burdensome, oppressive, or grievous. For whatever is born of God is victorious over the world, and this is the victory that conquers the world, even our faith. Who is it that is victorious over, that conquers the world? But he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God, who adheres to, trusts in, and relies on that fact. Now I'm going to unpack that a little bit. I'm going to unpack it the way I used to see it with my worldly mind and heart. Then I'll unpack the truth as seen through my renewed spiritual eyes. In verse 3, God asks us to follow his commands. As I mentioned earlier, before my mind was renewed, I used to rebel against anyone that told me what to do, even God. I couldn't help it. I was just programmed by the world to be that way. But if you pray and ask God to renew your mind long enough, he will change you. Now, here is my renewed perspective on these verses. In one word, wow. These three verses probably did more for my spiritual growth than any other. These three verses wrap up how much God really loves us in the most amazing way. Verse 3 says, for the true love of God is doing his commandments. I believe this has a double meaning. I believe we are to love him by doing his commandments, and that he also loves us so much that he gave us the commandments. Why? Because he doesn't want us sabotaging ourselves. The rest of the verse says the commandments are not burdensome. Why are they not burdensome? The answer is in verse 4. Because what is born of God is victorious over the world. And in verse 5, God even promises that those who adhere to and trust in Jesus are victorious and conquer the world. Now, how awesome is that? God tells us to obey him. He doesn't say that because I am the creator of the universe, and I am the supreme being, and I am so great that you must do as I say, because I have a big ego. No, our awesome God turns a command into something that is totally meant for our benefit. So we receive the victory that can only come from a loving God. Do you realize that every word of the Bible is meant for your good? I have been a stubborn, blind, arrogant meathead. Every single reason that we just looked at for loving God can be boiled down to 1 John 4:19. We love him because he first loved us. Okay, so far we've discussed that love, what love is and why we should love God. Now let's unpack the second part of Matthew 22:39. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. First, let's find out who our neighbor is. Then we'll discuss how we are to love them. We find a great example of how to love your neighbor, how to love our neighbors in the parable of the Good Samaritan. Luke also writes about the great commandment and how it leads to eternal life. In Luke 10, chapter 10, verse 25, and behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus said to him, what is written in the law? What is your reading of it? So the lawyer answered and said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said to him, you have answered rightly. Do this and you will live. But the lawyer, wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Then Jesus answered and said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a certain priest came down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Now you would think the priest would help, right? Likewise, a Levite, when he arrived at the place, came and looked and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, and he set him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. On the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, "Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, when I come again, I will repay you." So which of these 3 do you think was neighbor to him who fell among the thieves? And the lawyer said, "He who showed mercy on him." Then Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." Based on this story, I would say that our neighbor is anyone who is in need. This verse also answers the question of how we are to love our neighbor. In verse 36, Jesus asked the man, "So which of these 3 do you think was your neighbor to him who fell among the thieves?" And the man answered, "He who showed mercy." And then Jesus said, "Go and do likewise." Okay? We are to show mercy to others. It's sad that many times people get a little religion and think they're above other people, and they walk down the other side of the road when they see someone in need. Lord, please forgive me for all the times that I've done that. In Deuteronomy 10, 17 through 19, it says, "For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God all. The great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality nor takes a bribe. He administers justice for the fatherless and the widow and loves the stranger, giving him food and clothing. Therefore, love the stranger, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt." In Matthew 5:43-48, we read, "You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use and persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? Therefore, you shall be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect." We are to love those that we think are unlovable. We are not to judge and pick and choose who is worthy of our love. We are to let God be the judge, and he loves us all, and he made us in his image, so we are to do as he does. Let's take a look at some practical ways we can show love to others. In some of these scriptures, you will see very specific promises for the one who shows the love. So not only are the people we love blessed, but so are we when we show others God's agape love. Be flexible and put other people's needs first. In Philippians 2, verses 3 and 4, "Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look not only for his own interests, but also for the interests of others." When we do this, we are released from the spirit of pride that opens the door to the enemy. We are to serve one another. In John 13, verses 14 through 17, "If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." Now, did you catch the promise there? There's a double blessing. The people we serve are blessed, and so are we when we serve others. But let's make sure the motives of our heart are right. Give to give. We are not to give to get. Do not judge others. Matthew 7:1. "Do not judge and criticize and condemn others, so that you may not be judged and criticized and condemned yourselves." That has a promise attached as well. Do not judge and you won't be judged. Are you noticing that as we study love, God has designed everything to be a win-win-win? The person that we love gets blessed. The person acting in love gets blessed. And God set it all up so he receives all the glory because he designed and created it all to work together for good. And if we will become love, others will want what we got and they will be added to the kingdom. Forgive one another. Ephesians 4:32 says, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. We have already received this promise of forgiveness. Again, we have a win-win-win. Speak without accusing and judging others. So then in James 1:19, it says, "So then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God." Again, there's a win-win-win. It's a blessing to others when we hold our tongue. We become righteous in the eyes of the Lord. God wins because he can use our behavior to reflect his love. And I'm telling you, people will want what we have. I will demonstrate this in a story in just a few minutes. We are to encourage one another. In 1 Thessalonians 5:11, it says, "Therefore encourage, admonish, exhort one another, and edify, strengthen and build up one another, just as you are doing." So we're to uplift people, not tear them down. We are to give generously without sparing. Proverbs 21:26 says, "He covets greedily all day, but the righteous gives and does not spare." We are also to pray for others. In Job 42:10, it says, "And the Lord turned the captivity of Job and restored his fortunes. When he prayed for his friends, also the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before," simply because he prayed for his friends. We are to look for the good in people and not complain about them. In Philippians 2:14, it says, "Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless, children of God without fault, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world." That perverse generation has been every generation since the beginning of time. Isn't that what God really wants? He wants us to be lights in the world. He wants us to reflect love. After all, God is love. Jesus is love. Jesus is relevant in everything we do. Jesus is not just relevant in our church life, but in everything we do. He is just as relevant in our life when dealing with unbelieving family members. Who more than anyone else should we be extending the forgiveness, the encouragement, and the love of Jesus to? Jesus is just as relevant in our workplace. We are to serve in our work. The Bible says we are to do our work as unto the Lord. We should conduct ourselves in love as we work with others so people see that God's people are different. I'm going to wrap up with a story here. It was a turning point in my life, and this was back B.C., before I came to Christ. And it was actually back New Year's of 2000. I was working in the construction industry as a roofing salesperson. I had been working for a company named Born Roofing for almost 9 years. According to the world standards, I was very successful. I was making lots of money. By the world standards, I was earning in the top 2% of income earners in the U.S. The problem was I was miserable. I was working for a very abusive man. He was the ultimate example of a worldly, fleshly, greedy business person. He was very successful financially, but was spiritually bankrupt. To give you an idea of his nature, when I resigned, he asked me why I was leaving the company. So I explained that I had found him to be very abusive. His reply was, "I abuse my wife. What makes you special?" So imagine spending 9 years working for a man like that, just for the money. Okay? I believe God was already working everything together for my good. That was on a Monday. I think it was January 3rd, because New Year's fell on a Saturday. And by Friday, I had another job all lined up. At the new company, there was a salesperson. His name was John Adams. John could be Alec Baldwin's double back in the day. John was handsome, charismatic, and arrogant. I knew of John from industry events and stuff, but I didn't really know him as a person. Anyway, John was the only salesperson at the new company. He enjoyed being top dog. He had the whole territory of Orange County, Riverside, Los Angeles, and San Bernardino counties all to himself. You have to realize we are paid on commission, and now John has to share his territory with me. My coming there had the potential to affect his income significantly. So here is this good-looking, charismatic, stuck-up guy. So let me ask you a question. How do you think me coming to work there was going to go over? I kind of figured it'd go over like passing gas in church. Me being of this world, I just knew John was going to be totally bent out of shape. How else would he react? Well, let me tell you what happened. On my first day at the new company, my new boss takes me into John's office and introduces John and I to each other. Guess what John said? Are you ready? John said, "Tom, welcome aboard. Let me show you your new office, and I'll help you get all set up. Then we'll go have breakfast and figure out the best way to work together." So here I am, a man of this world, totally prejudging John, as the world does, as we all do. And here is John. This man had no other thought than to serve me. I was the new guy who many would have seen as a threat. Not John. He was different. When we went to breakfast, I noticed that this guy wasn't like most people I was used to working with in the construction industry. He was not anything like the way I had prejudged him. He wasn't arrogant. He was kind. He didn't gossip about others. He said good things about others. He didn't cuss like most other people in the construction industry. Later, I remember I was so moved by the way this man was, I even told my boss, I said, "Mike, this John guy is just the most truly quality human being I've ever met in my life." So I started wondering, what's up with this guy? Well, a couple weeks later, we went to lunch together on a Monday. And to make conversation, I asked John, "What did you do over the weekend?" And he told me that he had gone fishing on Saturday and that he had gone to church on Sunday. I asked if he went to church often, and he said, yeah, that he goes to church every week and that he was an usher and his wife served in some of the ministries. And I could sense this guy had a real sense of peace about him. Now, please understand that he didn't say any of this in a self-righteous way or act like he was better than me or anyone else. John was just a very mature Christian and was the best example of love in the workplace that I have ever seen. John wasn't trying to be righteous or be the example. John just lived his life the way Jesus commands each and every one of us to live. Back then, I thought to myself that someday, I hope I can be like John. I'm going to close with this. In John 14:6, Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Don't we all want our loved ones to know Jesus? This is just my opinion, but I believe that more people will be won over to Jesus by reflecting his love than by judging and condemning and telling them that they need Jesus. I have a question. Were not people drawn to Jesus because he extended love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control? Then wouldn't it be a good idea for us to do the same? I'm not saying we don't. I just know that I definitely have room for improvement. This is not something we can do in our own power. But Jesus has sent the Holy Spirit to give us the power to do this. Every morning we should pray that we can live and walk in the Spirit so that we can also extend the fruits of the Spirit to others. I believe that if we will develop the Spirit of love, we will almost by default develop the other fruits of the Spirit and become the living example that Jesus commands us to be. I believe the single biggest transformation I can experience will come through studying and living the great commandment of love. My prayer for you, for all of you, is that you will study how much God loves you, pray that God will open your hearts to receive more of his love, and ask God to continue to change your hearts and allow the Holy Spirit to lead you into being pure love. An easy way to remind ourselves to stay in a constant state of love is to let the old Beatles song, "All You Need Is Love," rattle around in our heads and our hearts. Amen. Thank you.
Praise God. Were you encouraged and filled up and blessed by that word?
just excites my heart. You know, that's the beautiful thing, you know, as our family, our church family, we come together. And like I told some people recently in the membership class that they had gone through, you know, we do this, friends, and we begin to discover who we are, our gifts. And Tom and Joanne were in that class and everything, too. And it's just neat how God will cause us, you know, maybe me or some leadership or different ones at church, you know what, Tom, he's really good at this and he does that and stuff like that. And then God opens the door for this individual, whether it's you, me, whomever, to begin to let God do what he wants in and through their lives. And that's beautiful because I know you guys are feeling just like, it's like, I just got filled up. I'm turned on. I'm excited, you know, and that's what the Lord wants, you know. It doesn't matter who it comes from, me or anybody else, but if we just open ourselves up and make ourselves available to the Lord, amen? Amen. Well, praise the Lord. I want to do just a couple of little things right now. Wonderful word that was shared. It is the truth that sets us the free and leads us to whom God wants us to be, become. And so this morning, as we've heard this truth, maybe you're sitting here and your heart is like, you know, I'm not connected to the Lord. I know what this man has shared from God's word and the personal events of his own life, but I want that for my life. If that's you here this morning, you can unashamedly ask Jesus to come into your heart and your life and make you the person that he wants you to be. If that's you this morning and you want the Lord to work his work in you, will you raise your hand before him this morning? And I want to pray. Praise God. Look at the hands that are raised around this place this morning. Hallelujah. That's what we want. And I don't do this often, but I'm asked, those of you that have your hands raised, stand up right where you are. Because you're saying before God, before man, I want to make a stand for you, Jesus. And let's pray, everyone, together. Just say these words of legion, some words, but let your heart just go out to God. Dear God, I come to you. Today I recognize my need for your love, and I open up, I receive the love that God you have for me. I thank you, Lord, for making me new and receiving me into your family. From this day forth, by your help, by your grace, I'm going to live for you. Thank you, Jesus, for accepting me. Amen. Amen. Now let's just praise God, put our hands together. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the truth that sets us free. Thank you, Lord, for our brother and the word that he brought to each and every one of us. We give you praise. We give you glory. And we thank you, Lord God, for the story that, Lord, you are doing in Tom Richardson's life. We thank you, Lord, for the story that you are bringing forth in each and every one of our lives. And we love you, Lord God. And we're going to follow you. And we're going to serve you in Jesus' name. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you and lift up his countenance and great smile upon you. And may he give you peace. Go in the peace of the Lord.